unbelievably, it's 21 years since I was last here. Yeah, I was an MSc student here in 1988-89, just for 1 year. And it's a bit like going back to your old school, really. Everything seems a little bit smaller. I remember looking at the Muirhead Tower and thinking, that used to be twice the size. It is a bizarre feeling, because you recognise bits of the campus, and then, but then you turn a corner and there's a brand new building, slap bang in your face. So, it's a regret that it's been that long since I've been back, but I'm delighted to be here and very privileged to be asked to perform the exercise of opening these weather stations. Yes, I've always had an ambition to be a weatherman, and in those days, in order to join the Met Office, you had to have a science degree, maths or physics, usually. I embarked on a physics degree at Salford University, but within the first year I'd failed all my exams and I was facing the prospect of getting kicked off the course. So I had a quick rethink and joined the geography faculty and did a geography degree, but of course that meant I wouldn't be able to join the Met Office. So I saw that Birmingham had an MSc in meteorology, and if I did that after my geography degree, that enabled me to join the Met Office. So that was my motivation for coming here. It's also a nice city, and it's not too far away from my parents, who live down near Evesham, so it ticked all the boxes for me. There were two of us on the master's course in meteorology, so it was Eddie and me, and it was very chilled out, and the lecturing style of lecturing in those days was very relaxed. I also met my my future wife here. She was training to be a physio in the city. So I've got fond memories of that, even though we're now divorced. We still get on very well, and we've got a son to prove it. So I met Lucy here, and it seemed a very villagey atmosphere to me. I lived up in Harbord, which is a great place to live. And just wandered down into the university every day. It was a 20-minute walk or something through the QE, and it was just very relaxing. You know, it was an environment surrounded by other weather enthusiasts. We had a little weather station up on the top of the Muirhead Tower called Birmingham University Weather Services in those days. And some of the faces are here today, who I remember from way back when, who've been kind of inspirational in my career. So it's great to be back. It brings back very fond memories for me. Weather broadcasting has changed an awful lot. I think the public's demand for accuracy is far greater than it used to be. You used to be able to get away with banal phrases like sunshine and showers, but such is the demand now, such as technology leapt on, that you can't get away with phrases like that. You have to be much more specific. And one of the reasons I'm here today is to endorse this new project for launching a weather station in the middle of the city, because that's going to give us tremendous insight into the urban climate, things like the urban heat island effect, which you may have heard of. Because traditionally, a lot of our weather stations are built on airfields or out in the countryside, which is all very well and good. But these days, most people live and experience the weather in urban areas. So it's incredibly important for us to get a greater insight into urban effects on the weather. And a lot of our computer models now are very high resolution, whereas in the old days when I first started broadcasting, typical resolutions of models probably 50 kilometres. It's now down to 1.5 kilometres, which is great, but in order to input observations into that computer model, you also need an observational network which is of similar resolution, which picks up urban effects. So you have to get good data in to get good data out. So that's another great reason why we're launching this weather station in the middle of the city centre, as well as one here at Edgestone. I did once famously, when I was working on ITV, we used to have to do the national weather on the right hand side of the map and the regional weather for some reason on the left hand side of the map, and one day I forgot which one I was doing, and of course I turned the wrong way, and I think that still regularly appears on Auntie's Blues or TV Nightmares sometimes. So that's one good one. The highlight though for me was having the chance when I was in the same studio as my rock legends, my rock heroes, Status Quo. And because we did the weather at the same studio that they were performing a single in, I managed to befriend Francis Rossi, and he asked me if I wanted to play with them at Wembley for their concert, which I did, and that is the greatest moment of my career. It's nothing to do with the weather, but for me as a Quo fan, it's just immense. I've never had a Michael Fish moment yet, although I'm working on it, because it didn't do his career any harm, did it? Let's face it. So the more I get it wrong, the better. I don't think we'll ever probably make the mistake that was made on that particular night way back in October 87, purely because our computer models are that much better than they used to be. On that particular occasion, I would say this, but we were very unlucky in as much as the direction of that storm changed critically by just a few miles, and it made all the difference in terms of wind speed across southern England. Obviously, in terms of the public, and their tree fell over their car, and their house was ruined by that hurricane. They've got no sympathy with the Met Office, and I completely understand that. From a purely scientific point of view, we only got it wrong slightly. but I don't think that we would make that kind of mistake again. So I guess in terms of those Michael Fish moments, there's less scope these days because we are better at what we do. We are now in an environment where we've got news and we've got pictures of weather all around the world at the time. And that does tend to sort of skew how we see these weather events and how unusual they are. However, I do think underlying all that is a trend for more extreme weather events, and it does certainly tie in with our global climate models, which do predict that we're not only just going to get hotter events, but on occasion, such as last winter, more extremes in the other direction. It's part of this shift. It is very difficult to sort of see the wood for the trees in terms of a pattern. And, you know, in any one year, the weather will do its thing. And the difference between weather and climate is something very difficult to communicate to the public. And it's very difficult to get society on board the message of climate change because of the variability of weather from month to month, from year to year. But if you look from decade to decade, there are clear signals. The weather is getting more extreme, and the temperature is rising. Because I'm such a nerd, and my favourite weather type is snow, I always choose a house that is a certain elevation above sea level in order to get as much snow in any one winter. So before I buy a house, and I'm in the process of looking for a new house, I always get the Ordnance Survey map and shade in the areas which are above 150 metres. And I only look for houses in those areas so that I can get as much snow as I possibly can in any one winter. So at the moment, when I go home this evening, that's what I'll be doing. I'll get the Ordnance Survey map and shading in the areas around northwest London which are above 150 metres above sea level. Sad but true.